In Search of Aztlan was a process that kind of that brought me back to where I was raised in Rio Rico, Arizona, which is on the border of Mexico and Arizona. After many years of having left the border and having migrated to Canada, and having survived cancer, the project was a method for me to kind of reconnect with my roots and reconnect with myself. It started off with a really simple question, which was, how can radio speak to place? Radio and I had become entangled. At a certain point, due to recovering from a brain tumor. And ever since then, myself and radio have become one. In a lot of ways, I became very obsessed with it and have researched it thoroughly, have also acquired my amateur radio license in 2020. But this project was a step into reconnecting with my identity and kind of accepting myself as a Chicano. I use the term Chicano X as a Chicken X as a term of to accept all of us, whether we're male, female, or other, into that culture and community. So this project was kind of, like I said, the first step of me accepting that word as a way to identify myself. And here's a quote from Gloria Anzaldúa, who says, "A veces no soy nada ni nadie, pero hasta cuando no lo soy, lo soy." This is like one of these texts from a Chicana artist, poet, as well as a researcher and academic, whose work really inspired this project. The book Borderlands was a big influence on me as I went through this project. And in the video work that is presented and in the gallery, there's a couple other texts from her. This one, "This is my home, this thin edge of barbed wire." This is another text that really resonated with me, sort of connecting with my roots along the border of Arizona and Mexico. So this project, like I said, it started off with a really simple question of how can radio speak to place? And I was interested in reconnecting with my identity as someone who'd grown up along this border. And I wanted to go there and see how radio transmissions could speak to what I knew was there. And radio has the really amazing quality that it can hop borders, and it does not need a visa. It does not need a passport. And so when you're in the border and you're from the border, you're catching transmissions from Mexico, even though you're not on the Mexican side, and you're catching transmissions from the US, even though you are on the US side. So radio really speaks to, it makes a really good example of how we're vectors, and we're just accepting these different sounds and influences to ourselves. And so when I started developing this project, it first really was this going down to the border and trying to understand what was going on down there. And for this project, I had received funding from the Council des Arts de Québec, as well as Canada Council for the Arts. And in doing so, I was able to travel down twice. And on the first travel, I made these antennas, which you've in the gallery, there's a farther developed version, but these were the first ones that I made. And they're really just really very basic Ojo de Dios. Then if the Ojo de Dios is an eye of God, that's the translation in English. And it's a design that comes from the Huichol in Mexico, which is an indigenous tribe. My father taught me how to make these as a kid. So when I was doing these Ojo de Dios, it was like a method for me to reconnect with those, that time and that place. And as I was doing it, I was also doing research on radios and crystal radios. And through that research, I came across the fact that crystal radio antennas were often designed as squares. And if you turn a square on its side, you get a diamond, and you're able to make it into an antenna this way. It doesn't matter which way it's sitting. And so I decided to make this antenna into an ojo de Dios, or make an ojo de Dios into an antenna. And the ojo de Dios, they're said to see the unseen. And so an antenna, the way it works for us as humans, is that it's able to hear the unheard. And so that was the play I was doing on the antenna and on the ojo de Dios, is fusing them together to kind of make this speculative antenna, which in my mind, by bringing it down to the border, I could listen to the spirits of the border, the non-human spirits of the border, and whatever they were able to capture. So these antennas, as ojo de Dios, an antenna is an antenna, but it also depends on what the receiver is. So I experimented with many different receivers. I made some receivers that were crystal radios. I also just used AM receivers, and also made these other receivers called a very low frequency, a VLF antenna, and those can hear like natural radio. And so these antennas I brought with me to the border, and basically was finding, on the first trip, I went back to my hometown and was just setting up these antennas around the way. And, you know, cars were driving by, and I don't think anybody was messing with me. I was nervous, but nobody was messing with me. I think mostly because they saw these weird crosses in the middle of the highway, and people didn't know what to expect or what it was. They're like, oh, he's into Jesus. We're not going to mess with him, or something like that. That's the vibe I was getting from people. But I was able to install them and kind of run some tests and see if this was going to work for me or not. And in part of that trip as well, I also volunteered for an organization called Humane Borders, which they deliver water for migrants. They have a system of barrels along the border where they're able to fill these barrels up with water. And so for me, it was important, even though this is where I'm from, and had been many years since I had been there. And at the time, this was when Trump was in president, and he was putting, you know, kids in cages and all that stuff. And I didn't want this work to speak to that specifically, but I wanted to engage with what was going on down there and be try to be useful while I was doing this work. And so I volunteered for this organization, and I went with these gentlemen to fill and bring water to a system of barrels. This is the truck that we took to get there, ride around in. We found like these type of rocks along the path, kind of pointing the direction on where to go for the water, as well as telling the migrants which way to go. And they would come across and find barrels like this with La Virgen put on them to let them know that it was good water, that water they could trust. And they had to, you know, these guys had to, the Humane Borders people had to really protect these barrels, because there's militia that's out there, and they would come to these barrels sometimes and they would have holes shot in them from guns. So the water had all leaked out. And so that's why they had to also add some of these system of locks, so to protect the barrels that were there. And when you're there, we would fill up the water, but then we would walk around a little bit, seeing if someone was around, or just trying to survey the area. And this is one of the volunteers that was there with us. And when you get to the water, they would install these giant flags, which you can kind of see how high up these flags go compared to these guys, how small they are compared to the pole. And on the tip of the pole, you'd find this flag. It just has, it's like a blue flag with a white water symbol on it, like a faucet symbol on it. And that was their way of letting people know that there was water that was there. So part of this process for me was going on the border with them, along the border with them to deliver the water. And in doing so, I was also trying to find locations of where I could set up these antennas and listen to radio. Because for me, there was a part of this journey that I was going on to reconnect with my roots and reconnect with home, as well as what was going on with these migrants who are leaving their homes and trying to find a new home. So there was some sort of resonance I found that was happening between the two works, or between what they were doing and what I was doing. But I was also just trying to keep it real and not get too caught up with what was happening. So through that process, I was able to set up these antennas, see that it was a good idea. It was working, it was rocking. And so I was able to come back and develop a new version of the antenna. I'm gonna quick stop this screen share to share with the process of these other antennas. So the other antennas that I built are these ones, the ones that you can see in the gallery. They look something like this. So as you can see, they're a little bit more designed. There's more of the fractal antenna that you'll see in Huichol, in Ojo de Dios, where you have the diamond and another diamond, another diamond. Often they'll have other diamonds on top of the diamond, so it continues the fractal. These were still prototypes because I wasn't able to fully get them finished with the other fractal aspect of the antenna. And because of COVID, it never quite happened. I was only able to go these times, and that was it. But the idea was to go to the border and make these really giant Ojo de Dioses that would just stay installed as like a land art piece. So let me show you a little bit of the process of making these antennas. Coming back, share screen. This here. Okay, share. So again, okay, so this is the process that I took to making these antennas. At first I started just taking copper wire and wrapping them around things and turning them into Ojo de Dios. So this is just like a copper wire, as you can see, wrapped around some pencils just to see if it would work. And then from there, I started making more of them and making bigger versions of them, and then expanding on that idea using the fabric and the copper wire. I haven't seen these. I was pulling these up recently. I hadn't seen these images in a long time. I forgot that I had made all of these, but I wanted to show some stuff that I hadn't shown in a while, or at all, actually. I don't think I've ever really shown these publicly. And then I started from there, decided to make a steadier design. So went to a wood shop where they helped me design these more, I guess, professional versions or more structured versions of the antenna. Here's a prototype, again, of the Ojo de Dios, just like a small one. I was continuing to develop this idea. And yeah, I had mentioned I had made other types of receivers, and this is a natural radio receiver that I brought it with me, that I was able to connect the antennas to this and listen to like the natural ionosphere. So kind of what was going on around the earth. And this was interesting for me because at the same time that I was doing all this research, I was also coming across research around radio telescopes and how we use radio and telescopes to understand, like to look in the farthest reaches of the universe to try and understand our origins. And so there's something there about searching for home, and not just searching for home on planet Earth, but searching for home and origin in the universe. And so this was interesting for me to make a radio receiver that was able to listen to the outer reaches of planet Earth. And so this is a radio receiver that NASA, a wing of NASA, has developed and released, where you can order them and they'll send you the circuit board with all the parts. So you just have to build it and put it together. And so I did build it. And this is an example of what this is what it looks like when it's finished. And so I brought this with me and was connecting my antenna here along the border and listening to whatever I could from along the border. This is a crystal radio, another version of the antenna that I was working with. more color. And I was trying to decide where to put the speaker because I wanted not only to capture the sound, or not capture the sound, but accept the sound, receive the sound, but also push out the sound so that it could resonate in our heard space. And I was just kind of testing different placements and experimenting with different pieces of copper and how copper could be integrated. My abuelita comes from Batopilas, which is also at the bottom of Copper Canyon. So there was something there with the copper. This is like some of the tests that I was doing when I'd bring these little receivers out into the world with me and try and just test them before going to the border. More of a mess, more mess. I like messes. Here's like a little bit of a circuit that I chopped up and put in the middle to say, oh, maybe something like that could look nice and function. Here it is. It's slowly coming together, a bigger version of the antenna. And then these are test prints of a fractal that I was putting in the center of this antenna. And this is how I etched the copper. I printed the design onto this paper, blue paper, that then you can put an iron onto the copper, and then you have to use ferric chloride. This is really bad, really toxic stuff. I would not do this process again because I'm just trying to be a little bit more conscious about my art making and the earth, planet earth. But basically you etch it, it cuts away the copper with ferric chloride and is protected by the ink and the blue. There's an example of what it looks like when the copper has been taken away. And so these are placed in the center of the antenna. They should work, but they could work as antennas, but I wasn't able to push it that far. But it's funny because as I was doing this project, I kind of felt like, oh, I couldn't get it as far as I'd want to. But in reviewing all these images and seeing this process, I realized how much I was actually able to accomplish. So it's really nice the fact that I kept these images. Here's a mess of a table, which is nice to show messy stuff. Here it is, the antenna again, more of an antenna, more of the antenna, kind of holding the antenna together, piecing it all together. Glue. And here's an amplifier that I kind of put on the back of it. More tests. Here we go. A lot of photos, testing it in the street before I brought it to Mexico. This more testing in the street. Okay, I'm going to hop back into the other presentation. I'm conscious of the time we got going on here. Your sound. So what happened with this project is I went down, I had done all this research, I had recorded sounds, I had brought these antennas down to the border. And then I was like, okay, and then what do? I was back in Montreal. And this was like January, February of 2020. I had applied and gotten more money from the Canada Council to go back and do the project for real, because those were all just research parts. Like I said, I wanted to do it and like leave these objects out in the desert to like stay there forever. And that was going to be a big process. But then, as we all know, 2020 happened, COVID happened, and Arizona was a hot spot for COVID. There was so many people that were dying of COVID at the time, and we couldn't leave the country. So I was actually very depressed, because this was a project that I was so passionate about and I was really building on, but I couldn't go. And so it was really difficult for me to try and understand what to do with what I had. And I didn't know what to do with what I had at the time. It was just a big question mark. And then a friend of mine asked me that during COVID, you know, people were trying to find alternative methods for performing and engaging still with work. And so a friend of mine was curating a show that was doing these performances in front of trucks that had advertising trucks that had these huge LEDs on them, so people could go and still have like audiovisual performances like in a park or something like that at night. And she asked me to pitch something for this project, and I was like, that's cool, but you know, you kind of have a giant screen on a truck, so maybe we should do this performance in motion. And so I said, you know, I think I have some footage that could be interesting to work with from this trip, and I want to do something with it, but I don't know what. And I had kind of forgotten about this footage until she had talked to me about it, because I had just taken it for myself to as a kid, remembering being in the backseat of the car. We were always driving to Tucson or to Mexico in my mom's car. And so as a kid, you only see from the back outside, from the back seat, you only can see from the window. And I was trying to just record that memory. I edited a film based on some of the footage I had taken while I was down there, as well as this GoPro that was basically stuck to the side of the car. So I want to just, this is a quick video. We can see the process of doing that, of this performance.
Artistic live. Hola amigos, espero que les vaya bien hoy, es un día muy bonito. ¿Qué bordes puede contener a la realidad?
Yeah, so that was really interesting for me, because it allowed this work to exist again, but in Montreal. So it like allowed me to bring the border over to the Canadian, over the U.S. border and over the Canadian border, and bring it over here. So there was like this displacement that was able to happen, and with these trucks moving and the way the footage was made, it allowed us it allowed like a window into the border from here, and like when the truck was moving at the right speed and it really, as you saw at the end of that last shot, it really looked as if it was just kind of opening this window up, and you could see other cars from the border that fit on the street but didn't fit on the street. And you know, so this process was really intuitive along the border, of just going, finding places that that I felt spoke to me, and also that just had interesting radio signals, or sometimes didn't have interesting things, and that was interesting as well. This specific location is the Buenos Aires Wildlife Reserve in the Sonoran Desert, and this is a place where a lot of the migrants cross. And this was a fire pit that I found there, and I thought this was an interesting place to stick the antenna and see if there was any stories that were coming from this fire pit, as often we sit around fire pits and share stories. And this is the fire pit that, if you go to the Sur Gallery, this fire pit inspired the installation, which is the the fire pit with the antenna in the middle of it. And so, yeah, it's really just kind of been a process of bringing this piece back with me and salvaging what happened along that border and the experiences that I had in that border and bringing it into an installation format. So for me, this piece kind of is multi-layered and has a lot of different pieces in the process where for me, the piece is definitely these interventions that happen in the border and listening to the radio signals and this as like a land art piece or as a sound art piece that exists here for the land itself. But then also the documentation of this work can be used and presented within the gallery as like the archives of this installation or of this intervention can be used as an installation. This is like some photos of me with the crystal radio. One of the interesting things that I love about radio is that you need in order radio just exists naturally, and with the crystal radio it's a circuit that allows us to hear these frequencies, but this circuit, like a crystal radio, it doesn't have a battery in it. So in order to close the circuit, because the circuit is a loop, in order to close it you have to put something into the earth and something into the sky and bring those together. And so what's happening here is I'm putting a nail into the ground to connect to the earth, and then the antenna is going into the sky to connect to the sky, closing the circuit. And I was doing this all along the border in different locations with my friend Jose Lozano, and he was helping me document this with a 16 millimeter, 35 millimeter, and Super 8 footage. And we were able to go to all types of high altitude locations too. We went to the top of this observatory. And here from this position, this is Mexico over here, and this over here is Arizona. So we were setting up the antenna and just listening to whatever we could capture, whatever was kind of coming through us. And at higher locations, you can hear more things. So we stayed up here for a really long time. And it was very beautiful to just be up there with this antenna and listening it's kind of hard to explain. And all the audio that you hear in the gallery is the audio that this antenna has captured one way or another. Sometimes it was recorded onto a cassette and the cassette wasn't properly calibrated, so it went like slow. And so that's why we hear some of these recordings, they sound like they're downpitched. It's because of just that slight error. I think I'll stop there because I want to make sure that we have time for questions, that Anahí has time to talk as well. So yes, I will pass it on to Anahí.
Great, thank you so much. And of course, we will have some questions afterwards, but I already have a few I'd love to engage with you, Martin. Thank you for a wonderful presentation. So now we have the pleasure to introduce Anahí González. And Anahí González is a Mexican photographer based in London, Canada. She holds a BA in communication from the Universidad del Valle de México, an MFA from Western University, and is currently an art and visual culture PhD candidate at Western University. González was selected to be part of the AGO times RBC Emerging Artist Exchange Program from 2022, and was a grant holder of the Sistema Nacional de Creadores de Arte en México, Generation 2021-2022. Selected exhibitions include Hacia Arriba, Upwards at Xpace Cultural Center, a core exhibition at the Scotiabank Contact Photography Festival in Toronto, and the Other Neighborhood of El Otro Lado, at the Art Lab in Canada and at the Nodo in Mexico. So now I would like to welcome Anahí. The floor is yours.
Hello, thank you, Tamara. I'm gonna be sharing my screen. See. Okay, well, thank you again. I want to thank Mariza, Rosales, and Tamara Toledo for the opportunity and for Cecily for facilitating tonight's talk. I'm going to be, throughout this presentation, I'm going to be talking about the two photographic series that are right now at Zurich Gallery, and also what I was thinking during that time, which was in 2021. But also a little bit of work before that. So boxes and trains are elements that are a constant in my artistic practice, working with cardboard boxes from Latin markets in Ontario as a sign of cipher, of an absent subject of labor. I bring attention and critique the power system, the system of powers that perceives Mexican labor as mobile, multipurpose, temporary, and sometimes disposable. I'm from the north of Mexico, 3 hours away from the Mexican border. My dad used to sing along with songs of Piporro, a northern Mexican humorous singer, songwriter, Los Tigres del Norte. And growing up, música norteña and corridos were music genres that I constantly listened to in gatherings and daily life. As a northern Mexican, it is common to hear stories in daily conversations and in the media of people migrating to the United States. Stories of people I might know, family members, or not. Many of these stories you can find in música norteña and corridos as a narrative evidence of the migrant experience, providing an in-depth history of Mexican border migrant culture. For example, actually, this is a playlist that I created in Spotify. If any of you want to know a little bit more about that music genre, you can like scan this QR code or you can send me a message after the talk. One example of música norteña is the following.
Porque somos los mojados, siempre nos busca la ley.
Just a little fragment. One example is from Piporro that says, antes iba al otro lado escondido de la gente, pues pasaba de mojado. Ahora tengo mis papeles, ya estoy dentro de la ley. Tomo whiskey o tequila hasta en medio del highway. And in English is, I used to cross over hiding from people because I cross as a wetback. Now I have my papers and I'm within the law. I drink my whiskey or tequila even in the middle of the highway. During my work in 2019 to 2021, música norteña, Latin markets, and ideas in relation to power systems that prefer products than people was something that I was interested and curious about. My hometown, it's industrial. It's also an in-transit city, meaning that migrants cross to go to the United States by train or migrant shelters as well. So listening, I use places and materiality to question these ideas or from my curiosity of the products that I even consumed and the lands that I was living at, Mexico and Canada. During that time, I recently moved to Canada in 2019. To London, Ontario. The Mexican community is smaller. I was missing home. Listening to música norteña made me remember my home, my dad, my family. But upon more analysis or questioning about this music genre or the songs that I was listening, I started looking for music or that songs that talked about Mexican workers or migrants coming to Canada. And I couldn't find. It was always about to the United States. And there's a great book, Música Norteña, from Kathy Raglan, that talks about the importance or the history of this music genre. So one of the concepts used constantly as an identity symbol in música norteña and corrido is the word mojado. Through the years, the word translated in English, wet bag, has been used as an insult to reference Mexicans in the United States. According to the American Heritage Dictionary, wetback defines a term for a Mexican, especially a laborer, who crosses the border between the United States and Mexico without papers. So, however, in música norteña and corridos, the term mojado, negative connotations are defied and effectively overturns the capitalist society's idea that human value is determined by a person's distance from manual labor. Mojado has emerged as an identity symbol of power and pride within the system of migration in the Mexican community. Because of its connection with labor, Mexico, and defiance, I was interested in the construction of the word mojado and labor within this lyrics and wanted to transform it into an image in a Canadian context. The creation of this new meaning was at the forefront of my practice during that time. And I made the photographic series Congelados, which congelados would be frozen. I selected lyric fragments from popular songs of Vivan los Mojados, El Mojado Caudalado, Chulas Fronteras, that narrated Mexican labor conditions, and I recontextualized them visually in Canadian landscapes. In one of the lyrics fragments, like the one that we read, the song narrates how originally the mojado moves during the night to hide from the law, and now that he's legal, he enjoys the freedom of crossing in the middle of the highway. I chose to photograph during the night to bring attention to the illegal conditions that Mexican labor faces and underline the coldness Mexicans can experience in Canada. But I've created an allegory of coldness, not only in terms of weather, but in the nostalgia of once belonging to a community that is no longer within arm's reach. I think about media portrayal of what was happening as what's happening right now and connecting it to in Canada. These two last ones are part of the show right now. When talking about the exportation and importation event, I question what and who moves? How do they move? Using empty cardboard boxes, like I mentioned, I use them as a sign of absent labor. The train is a constant element, was and still is in my practice. It carries goods to the up or north, and it provides transit for Latin American migrants moving across Mexico. I've found this act striking in relation to tracing human labor through my hometown train. I engage with what the train represents in this industrial network between lands. While the train carts can be loaded with goods made by Mexican laborers, they can freely enter the North American countries. Migrants jumping on the train are denied entry to such lands, and even the workers in Mexico. So through this exploration and understanding, I sense a deep heaviness every time I see the train in Mexico. The train cars inside are full of goods, and in their outside, traces of mobility remain: clothes, water bottles, cardboard, plastic bags, people that wear and are hiding on the train. In Canada, I sense a profound lightness every time I see the train. Some of the train cars are empty, others are still full. The exterior of the train cars feel different, even if some of them are the same. The traces that I saw in Mexico are impressive now. I connect the train carts, metal boxes, with cardboard boxes that I find in Latin markets. Both containers are filled in Mexico with goods and are delivered to the north up countries. From 2019 to 2021, I collected more than 200 boxes from Mexican products in Latin markets in the GTA, Elmer, London, so many. And just engaging with that material, I started noticing brands and just slogans, for example, the real Mexican flavor, or how the imagery was always about, for example, a mango with a mustache, or el charro with a sombrero, and sun and tacos. And that, just seeing that massive of icons, slogans, and texts, I started to cut them out and creating this. I see them as curiosity explorations, collages. I don't know. I see it as like cuts that I made through the boxes. And it's just so interesting how when you take them out from like cardboard boxes and you put them in the scanner, you start seeing special for tacos, or for example, the real Mexican flavor, or reúsame, regrésame, cuídame, and how those slogans, you can connect them to labor. And this exhibition, or this body of work as cajitas and content must be revised, were part of my MFA thesis show, The Other Neighbor of El Otro Lado, which was a simultaneous show, one in Canada, one in Mexico. And it was just very interesting how in Canada, it was just this pile of like more than 200 boxes. In Mexico, I show these fragments. And it's interesting the conversation between both exhibitions, but also between the works. And that's a little bit about my works. I just want to be mindful also about the time, because I'm sure there will be a lot of questions. I have questions for Martin as well, but I think I want to conclude with my presentation. Every time I go to a new place, I just look at the train and I look at the carts. And there was one time when I was in Mexico with my dad, we were looking at the train car. We were looking at the train and we're taking some like sand work for a piece. And I like working with my family when I go and explore my hometown. And we were looking at the train cars and it was like, okay, yeah, this one definitely is like an American one and this one. And then at the end, we saw Canadian Pacific Railway and we look at each other and I was like, we never saw that. I've never seen the card. And I remember my dad and I would just smile and I was like, sneaky neighbor. So I think I just want to encourage everyone just to, when you see a train, just thinking about what is inside those train cards and where they're coming from and where they're going. Thank you so much.